All right, thank you very much, Mike. Down here on the frozen tundra of Hancock Stadium as we're getting ready for a Class 2A battle between Carlinville and Coal City. It is very unusual in the state playoffs, the state finals, for the final game to be a rematch of a regular season game. Back in the second week of the season, Carlinville hosted Coal City and lost by the score of 7-0, but that may be ancient history, Bill Gorley.
Well, I really don't think it's that important. We've talked about it, we've heard about it in the media. The thing is, it was the second game of the season, Tom, and both teams have really tremendously improved as far as their passing game, both schools. And so I think you're going to see something a little bit different. Also, the quarterback for Carlinville, he only played, that was his first game, and he runs the option. And the option is a big part of Carlinville offense, and he's had 10 football games since then to get it going.
All the way back in September, after Coal City won, the players from Carlinville said afterwards, "We'll see you on the turf at Bloomington." Prophetic words, as it turned out, for all the way back in those warm days of September. Of course, little did they realize the condition of the turf they would meet on come Thanksgiving weekend here in Bloomington. So that sets the stage for our Class 2A battle between Coal City and Carlinville. We'll be back with that broadcast in just a little bit. In the meanwhile, we're going to send you back to Steve Cashel, who's back there in the warm, toasty confines of the Sports Channel Report studio. Steve?
Tom Stocker, Bill Gorley, gentlemen, take it from here.
All right, thank you very much, Steve. We're getting ready now for our Class 2A game here, as it's going to be Carlinville from down on the south central southwest part of the state against Coal City from just up the road at Interstate 55. Coal City, a team that a year ago went all the way to the semifinals, and they won the one meeting between these two teams back in the second week of the season, and they have put together an undefeated season.
Well, Coal City has 18 seniors coming back. And those seniors have won 42 out of 44 football games, Tom.
That goes back to when they were playing, of course, as freshmen and sophomores. It's still not a bad record, losing only 2 out of 44. Meanwhile, for Andy Easton, he was considered hanging it up after this, his 18th season as the head coach down at Carlinville. To put it in perspective, he's been at Carlinville for 18 years. Coal City has had a program for just 15 years, and he is actually reconsidering because he has quite a talented underclassman group on this team.
Well, he's reconsidering whether he wants a teach or not. As far as coaching football, with all the returning people, he comes back, and because they are a surprise, he thinks he might come back.
Both these teams feature all-state linebacker fullback combinations. Carlinville, Sean Call, he is the key. They have to establish his run.
Well, the big thing about Sean Call is they like to run him at least 30, 35 times a game. The problem is he also is their key linebacker on defense. And if they have to do that, you have to wonder, because Coal City is an awful big football team, and can he take that kind of pounding?
Matt Powell also is a very talented fullback linebacker for Coal City, but I think Coal City might have a few more weapons to work with. They've had a much more balanced offense this season.
Well, that's absolutely right. They're more balanced. They're willing to throw the ball. They've got people that can perform. And Carlinville is a typical fullback-oriented option football team.
All right, that sets the stage now for our 2A title game. Let's go down to the sidelines and our colleague Joe Passion.
Carlinville. Well, the road to normal has been an interesting one for both. You've covered already that they're familiar with each other from a game earlier in the year. But let's first check and see how the Cavaliers of Carlinville have made their way here to the tundra of Hancock Stadium. They have beaten some very good teams in making it here. And, of course, Carlinville is a team that's more from the south central part of the state of Illinois. And they are a team that's come here, and they do not mind the conditions of the field, despite how it is. They're ready to play with their turf shoes and a number of other different shoes. Now, as far as the Coalers of Coal City, just a bit south of the Joliet area along I-55, they are ready for this game too, and had to meet some very difficult opponents to get here in this championship game for the Class 2A. Coach Miller feels his team is ready. It's sunny, the wind is cut down, it remains cold, and the ice on the field is breaking up somewhat. Should help both teams. Let's find out who those teams are and go upstairs with our PA announcer.
Left in, number 40, Mitch Wagner. At left tackle, number 72, Spencer Call. At left guard, number 69, Shane Michaels. At center, Number 57, Rob Yowell. At right guard, number 62, Bill Bates. At right tackle, number 79, Joe Bulla. At right end, number 41, Doug Ryder. Quarterback, number 14, Josh Meyer. At halfback, number 26, Tunde Ridley. At halfback, number 21, John Reels. And at fullback, number 31, Sean Call. And the Carlinville head coach, Andy Easton. Introducing the Cole City defense. At left end, number 62, Jerry Cooper. At left tackle, number 76, James Krug. At right tackle, number 74, Jacob Kroll. At right end, number 47, Corey Wingerder. At tackle, number 67, Scott Miller. At linebacker, number 44, Matt Powell. At linebacker, number 42, Tim Mystic. At linebacker, number 34, Dirk Morris. The defensive back, number 24, Brad Skubik. At defensive back, number 25, Craig Van Dyne. And at safety, number 14, Brad Schmidt. And the Cole City head coach, Ken Miller. Ladies and gentlemen, please remember the name of...
So there you have the lineups for our two-way game, Carlinville and Cole City. Interesting that with the conditions that Carlinville, I should say Cole City, won the toss and will defer their option to the second half. And so they will kick off to begin this two-way title game. Interesting statistic defensively, Cole City this year, their defense has held their opponents to a total of 8 points in the first half all season long, 88 totals. The officials for today's 2A title game, you see the referee is Bob McDowell, John Swick, the line judge, Bob Avery, the umpire, Richard Considine, the linesman, and Daniel Raleigh is the back judge. Wind is still out of the south despite the chilly temperatures, and they're predicting the wind will switch. Right now it's 30 degrees, but that is probably as warm as it's going to get all day long. The wind will switch to the north later this afternoon, and when it does, the bottom will fall out of the thermometer. Obviously, Bill, the first couple of series, both teams are going to be testing out this turf, and really, I think they're going to be very tentative.
Well, the first problem they have is the turf, Tom, but the second problem that you have is trying to punt with this wind. The passing, if you keep the ball low, isn't such a problem, but once you get that ball up in the air on the punt, it's really difficult, and teams have had trouble the last few years.
Scott Miller, a one-step kick, fielded by Babatunde Ridley at the 25, and he is up to about the 32-yard line, about a 7-yard return. And so the Carlinville Cavaliers, their only loss this year out of 13 games. It's all the way back in those warm days of September. Let's take a look at Carlinville's offensive lineup. You see the quarterback is Josh Meyer. Sean Call is the heart of their offense, but Babatunde Ridley, a little 5'7 running back, if they can get him outside, they'll be successful. And you see Reels, Wagner, the rest of the ends. There's the offensive line that was a question mark at the start of the season, but obviously has really come together. First and 10 from the 32. That is Ridley trying to get outside. Corralled by Tim Mystic, the 5'11 linebacker, and cornerback Brad Skubic for the stop on the play.
You have to be a little bit concerned trying to go wide with poor footing, but Carlinville coach Andy Eason has decided to go outside, and of course you've got that number 42, Tim Misetich, coming out and making the tackle.
A loss of two, it's second down and 12. Rolling out is Meyer, and it's intercepted. Intercepted by Craig Van Dyne, and he is in for the touchdown. Wait a minute.
And they may have called him out at the one time.
They called him out at the 10-yard line.
Right
at the 10. He just stepped out of bounds. There was nobody near him.
Well, it's very difficult to see because all this ground is frozen, and we'll get a chance to see where he comes out of bounds. Here's the pass, and Cole City just steps right up in front. Makes a tremendous play. He read it perfectly, and of course with the footing, and we'll see him right here. He steps out of bounds. Well, it's close, Tom. He threaded it pretty close, but apparently the official who was right behind him felt he went out about the 10-yard line. We'll get another look at it from a different angle.
Bill, interesting, that is the 29th interception of the year for
He's
Cole
out.
City.
Yes, and they only need a couple more to break the IHSA record.
They are third on the IHSA all-time single-season list in interceptions. There is the pitch, and trying to get outside on the near side is Mystic, the wingback. And he gets a couple of yards. Mystic, a 5'11", 180-pound senior, who averaged nearly 6 yards a carry this year, has over 620 yards so far this season. So it's first and goal, I believe, at the 10. And it is. It's second and goal at the 9. Take a look now at the quarterback and the receivers with Skubic, the quarterback. Powell really the heart of their offense, but Van Dyne is an outside threat. And Brad Schmidt could be the key offensive player for them from a wideout position. A very solid, good offensive line. That is Van Dyne, and he is inside the 5-yard line.
You know, Tom, it surprises me a little bit that Cole City has opt to run sideways instead of running straight ahead. We'll get a chance here. Van Dyne, who ran, he ran in a slant. And I think with the way the field is, you've got to run right at people. There is no footing, and we're going to probably say this quite a few times, but I think you've got to run straight ahead today.
Quarterback Brad Skubic, his cousin, Kurt, was a 2-year starter the last couple of years, led them to the semifinals last year. Third and goal from the 5. Straight up the middle, touchdown, Matt Powell, his 16th of the year.
I'll tell you what, Tom, I don't know if I'd want to get in his way. We saw him downstairs, and he supposedly goes at 210, but the coach said he goes at 226, and I believe every pound is a solid, young, fullback-type runner. Here he doesn't have to use his feet. He's just going straight ahead with those big thighs and those big calves.
How about that block by the center, and Shane Bishore,
right.
155-pound center.
He just manhandled him, and there's the kick.
Point after by Scott Miller is good, who's now missed only 6 out of 39 all year long. 7-0 in favor of Cole City with barely 2 minutes gone here in the 2A state title game at Hancock Stadium. The Kohlers of Cole City cash in on the Van Dyne interception. Powell's 5-yard touchdown, and it's 7-0 early in the first quarter. And once again, Scott Miller will kick. And it will be taken by an up man at the 25. And he's still on his feet to the 40, 41-yard line. That was Sean Paul, and he was very tentative every step of the way.
Yeah, he's really tiptoeing, and I would not be surprised if we don't see Carlinville go straight ahead. No, Tom and I, you and I were talking at the break about the possibility that Carlinville might be scripting their plays and looking at a dry field, and they've got to change their idea here because they cannot get any footing. The receivers can't get deep. They can't challenge because of the ice on the field.
So Josh Meyer, indeed, that time hands off to Sean Call, an all-stater this year, had over 1,300 yards. On the tackle, the Rover linebacker, Dirk Morris for Coal City. And you see the very quick scoring drive of just 10 yards, three plays, again set up by the Craig Van Dyne interception. The 29th interception this year for Coal City.
This is the one thing that you didn't want to, Carlinville didn't want to have happen, was to fall behind early because they're not a passing football team.
Second down from the 46, second and five. That play goes nowhere up the middle. And coming out of there, Jerry Cooper and Scott Miller. That was Cooper, 62, the All-State left end, who has 12 tackles behind the line of scrimmage this year.
And of course, he's an All-Stater with the Chicago Sun-Times, chosen 6'3", 235. You know, these schools may be 2A as far as school enrollment, but size-wise, they're as big, if not bigger, than some of the 6A teams.
Third and three for Carlinville, just on their side of midfield. That's Call trying to bounce outside, and he barely gets back to the line of scrimmage. Tim Mystic slowed him up. Also getting a hand in there was Corey Wingerter, the defensive right end.
I think we'll get a good example here of what we're talking about with Sean Call. Sean is trying to run laterally. With the size and everything that he has, he's got to run straight ahead. He's a bull-like runner, fullback, and he's definitely got to run straight ahead. He cannot run laterally, particularly, again, with the field conditions.
That's Mitch Wagner punting, averaged 32 yards a punt, but didn't get very much on this one against the wind, as Carlinville will let it roll, and it finally is dead just outside the 26-yard line. And that's where Coal City will take it over, first and 10.
You can see in your picture right there all the snow that's come off the field so that they at least get it so it's somewhat playable. But again, the punt up in the air was held up and did not get the yardage that you would normally get here at Hancock Stadium.
I didn't know if that was a punt or we were going to get an icing whistle on that play.
Well, look at their helmets. They've got ice on their helmets, too.
So Coal City leading by the score of 7-0 with just under 8 minutes to go in the first quarter. Has it for the second time, but the first time on its own side of the 50. And getting hit quickly was Mystic. He was lined up at the fullback position and gets a yard, maybe two. In there on the stop was Sean Call, linebacker. Also Bill Bates, you see, number 62. Defensive left tackle, two-year all-conference player for Carlinville.
And that defense that Carlinville has, across the front goes 220, 225, 240, 210, 200. So they've got some good-sized people playing defense.
Second and eight. Skubic may be changing the play at the line. Again, that's Mystic. Good blocking up the middle, and he gets up to the 32-yard line. Picks up about four. Doug Ryder, the middle guard, makes the tackle, assisted by Rob Yow. But what a job by the middle part of that offensive line, especially that little 155-pound center, Shane Beeshore.
Well, you can't hardly see him at offensive center because he's flanked by two 200-pounders, two tackles that weigh 240 and 225, but you have Shane Beeshore, who's making quite an effect as far as his blocking ability is concerned.
Kind of like Marv Froberg. I'm not sure why they asked me to do this. I'm 155 pounds.
Well, he's doing it.
Third down and four, and that is Powell with a first down and then some to across the 45-yard line. The All-State fullback, Matt Powell. John Reels, strong safety, makes the tackle.
Interesting to see the comparison of styles between the two fullbacks. Now here's Matt Powell, who can and seems to be able to run laterally, and he can also go straight ahead, whereas Sean Call is having difficulty running laterally and he needs to go straight ahead.
12 yards on the running play for Powell. So it's first and 10, spotted at the 44. They fake the wing back reverse. Here's Scuba going to put it up. He's got a man, and it's caught. That is Brad Schmidt. We told you before the game he could be their big play man, and he is down to the 10-yard line.
Well, that was a great fake by Scuba. We have to see the replay on this one. Watch the fake. I mean, this is a nonchalant fake. He looks like he doesn't have the ball, and there's nobody challenging him, and he throws the ball right on the money to Brad Schmidt. Makes a great catch.
John Reels and Babatunde Ridley were able to get back there to save the touchdown.
Well, they were fooled by the fakes, there's no question.
But when the ball was thrown, Schmidt was not close. He had to really catch up, get it.
Getting outside, that's Van Dine.
Ridley was over to knock him off his feet. And about the 6 yard line, pick up about four on the play. Just under 6 minutes now to go in the first quarter.
There's no question that the game plan is unfolding for Cole City. They want to jump on top of Carlinville fast so that they force Carlinville to do the one thing that they can't do or haven't done well, and that's throw the football.
It is second down and five from just outside the five. They could conceivably get a first down without scoring. Skubik, the toss goes to Powell. Can he win the race to the corner? Yes, he does. Touchdown, Cole City.
I tell you what, he has a lot better speed than you would imagine in a fullback like that young man at 226 has. He can really turn it on. He just beat the corner. And you could see he was looking at the corner, knew just how much faster he had to run.
You know, you put sandbags in the trunk of your car, get a little better traction on the ice. He's got built-in sandbags right there at 226 pounds. And he is a load to bring down. The point after is good. And so, with not quite 7 minutes gone, Cole City with a big 14-0 lead early in the first quarter.
Well, we'll get to see Matt Powell right here on a pitch. And he's just going outside. He tucks it in. And right about here, you can see he can turn it up a little bit because he saw the corner. And he didn't even pay any attention to him. He just went right for the flag. We'll get a good angle right here where you can actually see where he's just kind of looking at the hole right there. Now he sees it. Now he turns it on. And he just races right to the corner. And there's no way anybody can catch him. That's 226 pounds of... Well, I saw him down in the locker room, and he is really put together. And he's a good athlete.
The big play, of course, in the drive, the 46-yard pass play to Schmidt. Schmidt, of course, was the one who scored the touchdown on a screen pass to beat Carlinville back in September. So once again, Scott Miller will kick off his third kickoff. Again, it's taken by an up man at the 20. That is John Reels. And pushed out of bounds just inside the 44-yard line by Corey Wingirder. Return of 25 yards on the return for Reels.
Now, maybe it's because you're not as heavy that you can run better, because that young man ran pretty well and did a nice job moving laterally as he went upfield.
Second 5-yard touchdown of the day for Powell, capping off the 74-yard drive. It took just a little under 3 minutes. It's at Carlinville's 45, and it's first and 10. Just over 5 minutes to go in the first quarter. Josh Meyer is going to put it up again. Now he's going to run. He's able to get outside of Wingirder. And he's able to make something out of nothing. Get up to about the 48, pick up about three.
And that man, number 44, Matt Powell, came from the outside to make that tackle. And I think we can see what kind of ability this young guy has. He's moving laterally right now, doesn't seem to have any difficulty. He sees the quarterback at this point, continues on to move laterally. Now watch when Josh Meyer makes a move, how he comes from behind and extends that arm to get him, looking for the possibility of knocking that football out.
Second and eight, Meyer rolling out. And he tucks it up under his arm again, and he's into Cole City territory at about the 48. Dirk Morris makes the tackle.
You know, it's interesting the willingness that Carlinville has at this point under the conditions that we're seeing to want to throw the football. I know in 1978, Coach Easton came here with a team that was going to run the football. And he lost the championship 9-0 to Stockton because he wanted to run and force the run. Now he comes into this game with the idea that he might need to pass it, and the conditions aren't really good for it, and he hasn't run much of the option at all, which is what they mainly have been known as, an option football team.
I'm not so sure if Meyer was ever intending on throwing it the last time. I think he was just trying to freeze the linebackers in the secondary.
Right. I think you're right, Tom.
Hard-earned yardage inside the 40-yard line. That is Sean Call, their All-State fullback. Jacob Krull, right tackle, makes the stop for Cole City.
Well, this is what Sean Call does the best. He runs off the tackle and then runs straight ahead, runs into his own man, continues on, and then, of course, you've got number 47, Corey Weingutter making the tackle.
It's at the 37-yard line. That's the first down of the game so far for Carlinville. Delay goes to Mike Johnson, and he ran right into the pile. What a job by the middle three of the 5-2 defense for Cole City. They just stood the Carlinville lineman straight up, and there is no place for Johnson to go.
Well, at the top of the showtime, you pointed out the fact that that Cole City has scored 308 points in the first half and only allowed six. And I think you're seeing a good idea of why that occurred during the other 12 football games that they played this year.
It's second and 12 from the 39 out of the shotgun. Meyer has a man open. He had reels wide open but threw it behind him. He got in the middle of the zone coverage and had a seam there between Brad Schmidt and Matt Powell, but the pass went behind him.
Well, Coach Easton talked about the possibility of showing the shotgun, which again is unusual for a team that is willing to run the option, but they went twins to one side and they were covered, and the footing again, the big problem for the ball game. Whatever game is going to be played, whatever class, they're going to have some problems.
Now they have a single setback formation with twin wideouts to the left side. And that is Call. Call with a first down. Still on his feet to about the 22-yard line. He picks up 17 and a first down. What they may be doing right now, Bill, is maybe using the pass or the threat of the pass to try to open up the middle.
To spread them out. Exactly. That's what's happening right here. They went to their twin formation. Cole Russ runs straight ahead, which he does very well. And then you'll see he's brought down here by Brad Schmidt. I'm sorry. We've got the wrong numbers here. We're talking about number 33, Mike Calderon.
First and 10 from the 22. That's Call hammering through the left side to about the 16. He picks up 6 yards there. This is a big drive for Carlinville. If they can come up with a touchdown on this drive, they're right back in it, and they can shake those early jitters.
Exactly, and I think that of the two teams, Carlinville has just had more difficulty trying to adjust. And again, I think they came in here with some scripted plays or scripted ideas of what they want to do offensively and said, forget what the weather's like, let's just do it, and it hasn't worked out.
Well, on the front end, Andy Easton said, I'm going to throw more than maybe Carlinville teams normally do. Second down and 5. Toss goes to Ridley. Trying to play off a block. He picked up about 4 yards on the spinning tackle of Brad Schmidt. Schmidt stopped him at the 10, but by the time he spun Ridley down, Ridley only 5'7", he got all the way up to the 6-yard line, and it's first down.
Well, Tinge Ridley is just a little guy, 5'7", 135. He's a sophomore, and he follows his blocking real well, runs excellent, and of course, as you can see, the turf there is a little bit free of the ice, and he gets a little better footing.
First and goal from the 6 for the Cavaliers of Carlinville. This is the 9th play in this drive for Carlinville. Call slamming on a slant through the right side of the line to about the 4.
Now he's running off tackle, and Jerry Cooper comes in there, number 62, to make the play. And again, it's all-state player against all-state player, and this is where it all is counts. Whenever you get down in that goal line area, you'll always see those people that we talk about at the top that we feel are going to play well, and they live up to that possibilities.
Second and goal from the 4. Quickly switching out of the eye to the T is Mike Johnson. Paul, quick handoff. Hit immediately, though, by linebacker Matt Powell. Again, all-stater against all-stater. What a job by Powell as he knifed through the offensive line. And he hit Call immediately.
Well, here's the two best fullbacks probably, and we'll see in probably both classes. And Matt Powell came right across the line of scrimmage to hit up number 31, Sean Call. So you've got two great football players, and we came in here knowing that both of these teams were fullback-oriented, and we saw a good example of it right there.
Double tight end set on third and goal from the 5. Big play here for the Cavaliers. Play action play to Call. Throwing for the corner. It's up for grabs, in and out of the hands of Mitch Wagner. Very closely covered by quarterback Brad Skubic.
Brad Skubic, one of nine players going both ways. You know, you don't, the one guy you really don't want to have to play both ways is your quarterback, but Brad Skubic is an exceptional player and reaches over the top.
And that is the final play of the first quarter. After one quarter, the Kohlers of Coal City with a two-touchdown lead in the 2A title game at Bloomington Normal. On the first play of the second quarter, Carlinville's Mitch Wagner will try his second field goal attempt of the year out of the hold of Babatunde Ridley. The kick is no good. So Coal City's defense again, but a penalty marker is down on the play. And it is running into the kicker against Coal City.
Yes. That's a big break. Now, you try it again, or do you?
That's half the distance, so it'll go just inside the 3-yard line on fourth and goal.
We'll get a chance to see who ran into Mitch Wagner. It was a high snap. He kicked the ball, but it looked like he slid a little bit, and it went off to the left. And obviously no good, but you couldn't see who interfered there.
Somebody from the middle of the Coal City defensive line just popped right through, and I didn't look like he had, plenty of time.
Happened into the goal line, first down.
It is a first down.
Well, that'll change what they want to do now. They obviously are going to run the football. They're not going to go back into kicking formation.
So it'll be first and goal from just inside the 3-yard line. What a big break,
for
the Carlinville Cavaliers. But it looked like they had a great drive, come away empty. Myers just does get it off to Call, and he's in for the touchdown. So
I
the Carlinville.
I saw a flag. You know, it's difficult to see the flags with that. With the way the sun is shining, but I definitely saw a flag, and the officials are talking about it right now.
Well, you have, of course, Coal City with their yellow numerals and yellow headgear, and the penalty marker indeed thrown at the line of scrimmage. So now we will check with referee Bob McDowell.
On the play, we have a face mask. It's declined. We have a touchdown.
Touchdown, Cavaliers. So their All-State fullback, Sean Call, gets his first score of the day. And now, instead of the field goal attempt earlier by Mitch Wagner, now he'll try for his 30th extra point of the season.
They're looking like they're going to go for two.
Yep, indeed, they're going to do that. That's Josh Meyer being strung out, and the try is no good as he is flattened by Jerry Cooper, the All-State defensive end for Coal City.
I want to say I saw another flag, Tom. Here's the touchdown. Now, this is a classic run by your option fullback. He just made that little turn, turned it up inside, and that's what he does best. Sean Call making the touchdown, and then, of course, there was a penalty, but I believe that that was... Was there, in fact, a penalty, Tom?
There was a penalty, and it apparently was declined.
Okay. I thought I saw a flag. You know, with those yellow outfits on and the way the sun's coming down, it's difficult to see that flag, but I thought I saw one of the officials throw a flag.
So it's 14-6. So Coal City, who had given up a total of 8 points all season long in the first half, sees Carlinville score for the first time against the Kohlers' defense this year with that touchdown, aided, of course, by the big penalty call, roughing the kicker penalty.
Well, now you have to wonder what offensive philosophy that Carlinville will have now that they are only down 14-6. Will they try and spread the people out a little bit, go with an unbalanced line with twins to try and force Coal City inside and then where they can get the ball outside?
Mitch Wagner will now kick off. Among the two deep backs for Coal City is Craig Van Dyne, who has 4 kickoff returns for touchdowns this year, which has tied an IHSA record. A record that was first set by the great Walter Eckersall of Hyde Park in 1902. Bill, you called that game, didn't you?
Yes, and Eckersall, there's a stadium, Eckersall Stadium,
sure,
named after him.
Of course, back then the field was 110 yards long, remember? Seriously.
You're right.
The kick by Wagner. And that is Van Dyne. He tentatively follows his blockers and falls forward to about the 28-yard line. That's where the Kohlers will set it up. Down on the sideline, let's check with our colleague, Joe Passion.
Well, Carlinville has had a rallying point all year long, guys, and his name is Wayne McFarland. I don't know how good of a look you can get at Wayne with a thumbs up here. Wayne was to be their starting fullback this year. He's a senior. He was in a serious auto accident back in July, was in a coma up until just a few months ago. And now at St. Mary's Hospital in St. Louis, he's recovering, still paralyzed on his left side, but he's very alert and is listening, watching to the game here and hoping his Carlinville teammates will rally around his spirit as they have all year long. And this is Wayne, thumbs up from the hospital, just out of a coma a few weeks ago. And his number 23 jersey has been their rallying point all season long. Maybe they'll continue to make it work for them here in this 2A championship game. Back upstairs, fellas.
And a big thumbs up to Wayne from all of us with Sports Channel. Second and 12 now for Cole City from the 26-yard line. A little razzle-dazzle out of the backfield, a little wing-back reverse. And that is up to the 32-yard line. That's Mystic, who came around from right to left. Let's take a look at the Cavaliers' scoring drive that went 55 yards, took 13 plays, aided, of course, by the big roughing the kicker penalty on the missed field goal, and it took nearly 5.5 minutes.
That's a good view of for our fans to take a look at what the field actually looks like, what they're playing on, so they understand what we're talking about the ice time.
Third and 5 from the 33. In motion goes Powell. Now Skubic wants to put it up. He's looking for Powell, and he holds it in at the 50. And he is down to the 40, make that the 36-yard line. Mitch Wagner on the stop, the free safety, 31 yards on the play, and they're in Carlinville territory.
Well, Cole City gives you multiple formations, and we'll see a different formation right here. And you'll see Matt Powell, he'll actually look back like he's not even going to be in the pass play, and then he turns it up upfield and makes a nice catch. It shows you the versatility that Matt Powell has as a football player. We see him both as a pass catcher, a runner, and as a linebacker.
So Powell with his first catch of the day. Now this is Mystic with a block, cuts behind the block to the 30-yard line. That time it was Powell leading the way for his flanker teammate, Tim Mystic.
And Matt Powell, I guess you have to say he does it all. He blocks, he runs, he catches passes. The only thing he didn't do so far, we haven't seen him kick the ball. We don't see if he punts or kicks extra points or anything like that.
Mystic picked up 8 yards on the running play, setting up second down and 2 yards to go, under 10 minutes now. 4 first downs now in the ball game for the Kohlers of Cole City. Powell straight ahead, gets the first down as he picks up 4 yards on the running play to the 25.
And Sean Call, number 31, in on the play for Carlinville. Now, Powell was only about 2 yards deep. Again, it's a multiple formation. Now, Coach Miller runs a lot of different plays, but he runs them all from different formations, which really gives you some problems defensively. And if you have the opportunity to watch game after game, you might be able to get his formation tendencies, but it's difficult to do on a day like today.
Toss goes to Powell, going to the short side of the field, and it's Spencer Call who yanks him, make that Sean Call, who yanks him down from behind on the near sidelines at about the 19-yard line. Normally, you would see Cole City throw the ball a little bit more. After all, Skubic this year has passed for over 1,200 yards. Sean Call, you see right there, number 31, was the first freshman that Andy Easton ever started in his 33-year career as a linebacker, ever. First freshman ever to start.
And he really didn't want to play him at fullback, and we saw the reason why he had to play fullback when we saw Wayne, who was in the hospital.
Coming around on the near side, that's Powell. He's to about the 7-yard line. Gets another first down for Cole City. Babatunde Ridley, a little 5'7 sophomore who's not afraid to stand in there against the big guys. Just that he likes to see him coming. He's not afraid to stand there, square his shoulders, and make the block, make the tackle.
But I would think that if you saw Matt Powell coming at you, it might be a train without a light on, and you might want to get out of that way.
There is a penalty marker down on the play, however.
We have holding on the offense, 10 yards. Remain second down.
So we'll go 10 yards back to the spot of the foul.
Now we might see a little bit of their passing game. Well, there's the icicles we've been talking about that have been dripping all over this field. Although the sun is starting to come out, Tom, maybe it'll dry it up a little bit for some of the games later on.
Only to refreeze when the bottom drops out of the thermometer expected tonight. Timeout has been called by the Cavaliers, and you see just a couple of penalties so far in this game. We've got a break in the action, 8:20 to go in the second quarter, 14-6, the Kohlers leading Carlinville at the 2A title game on Sports Channel. On second and 15, that is Mystic getting to the 20-yard line. As he picked up 10 yards on a second and 15. Cornerback Sam Rhodes, maybe the most underrated player in the defensive secondary for Carlinville, makes the stop. Had a great game in the semifinals against Paxton Buckley-Loda. And an interception also caused and recovered a fumble in that game. From the 20, it's third down and 5. Back to throw is Steuben. Now he's plucked out of the pocket and he is sacked by Joe Bula. The 6'3", 200-pound senior drops him all the way back at the 30-yard line for a loss of 10.
Prior to this, Tom, Cole City has been running formations. Unbalanced, one back, twins, power eye, two tight ends. Here's a good example. They had one back, and they're forcing adjustments. But Joe Bula didn't have to have any adjustment. He just came right across the line of scrimmage to make the tackle.
Again, normally through the course of the year, Cole City has been much more of a balanced team compared to most other small schools, but they've been so successful running, I was surprised to see them in a third and 5 situation in a drop back pass. Fourth and 15. Now is the call. And it's caught. Caught by Corey Wingartner. It's fumbled and recovered by Carlinville. Wingartner had it. He fumbled and it was recovered.
That was a tremendous hit, Tom, and Wingartner really coughed it up. We'll get a chance to look at that. We'll see it right now. Skubic throws a nice pass. This is the same pattern they threw earlier, and obviously the coaches saw Wingartner coughed the ball up. We didn't get a chance to see. Maybe we could see it by another angle. Who
Wagner?
Made.
Wagner caused it.
Was it Wagner? Okay, and good. There's an angle. Yes, we can see it right now. There he is coming. Oh, wow. And he just hit him, and the ball went out. And, of course, now Carlinville's got it inside a 10-yard line.
Jeff Bulla, I believe, was the one who recovered. So they stop him inside the 10. It's first and 10 from the 4-yard line.
As far as I'm concerned right here, Carlinville's got to go back to what they were doing before, where they were spreading Cole City out, forcing Cole City to try and come out and play him a little bit. They had a little more success then trying to run Sean Call up inside.
Second down, 8 yards to go from the 7-yard line deep in Cavalier territory. There you see head coach Ken Miller, his 8th year as the head coach of the Kohlers. 24-2 that team the last 2 years. Second down and 8. Keeping his feet, good job keeping his balance with Sean Call. And he is up to the 10-yard line as he picks up 3. Corey Wingartner, who had his bell rung in coughing up the fumble on that reception, comes back to make the stop.
Sean Call looks to me like he's adjusting a little bit better to the way the field is, and as the game has progressed, he started to get a little bit more yardage and get the yardage that he's capable of getting.
It'll be third and about 4 yards to go, the ball just outside the 10. Wagner, the lone wideout, goes wide to the far side. There you see him in the upper corner of your screen. Again, Meyer rolls out to throw. He's got a lot of room to run. And he's got the first down.
That quarterback rollout has been one of their best offensive plays. Whether he really and truly wants to throw the ball or not, he's able to roll out and get the yardage. We'll see Josh Myers roll out. He looks like he's going to throw the ball, but the way that everyone is bunched in, it looks to me like he's really running. As far as I'm concerned, it's a quarterback run.
Well, it was a great job by 79 Bula, the right tackle, to seal off the defensive line and open up that lane for Meyer to get outside.
That's why you have to wonder if it wasn't just a run all the way.
That's Babatunde Ridley. He is strung out and hit hard by Jerry Cooper. Babatunde Ridley, a little 5'7", 130-pound sophomore, but there you see the All-State defensive end, Jerry Cooper, 12 tackles behind the line of scrimmage this year out of 94 total stops this season. A loss of two on the play, and it'll be second and 12.
Well, you were talking about Ridley, number 26, and you call him Babatunde, but they call him Tinge.
Tinge.
I think that's a little easier.
From the 18, second and 12. Just over 5 minutes left to go in the first half. Couple of play fakes by Meyer. And the pocket collapses on him, and he is able to get back only to the 16-yard line and loses 2 yards on the play. There you see Corey Wingerter, the 6-foot senior who made the tackle.
Excellent defense by Cole City. They're keeping Josh Myers inside. He makes the fake inside a call, makes another fake, then comes out, and he really doesn't get the depth that he needs, and Wingeitner comes up inside to make the play after he forced Josh Myers to go inside.
Third and long. Meyer again rolling out, but under pressure, finds a man, reels, makes the catch, and he is labeled on the play by the Rover back, Dirk Morris. What a hit there by number 34, who's among the top 10 scholastically in the senior class.
Here we're getting a good example of that kind of hit. As soon as he makes the catch, excellent play, excellent.
So it'll be fourth down, and so Carlinville's Mitch Wagner, who averaged 44 yards a punt the first time they faced Cole City, is back to take the snap inside the five. End over end. Brad Schmidt had to go back to the 45. Now he hands it off to Van Dyne. Great fake by Van Dyne. He coasted. Now he's going to go down to their sidelines. He could go all the way. He gets a block. And he's out of bounds at the 15-yard line. What a job by Van Dyne to coast after he got the handoff, to coast as if he didn't have the ball.
And that was the same play that Skubic made earlier on the pass. They've worked on this for a long time.
Look at, he put it on his side and just nonchalantly.
And then turned it up.
Like a bootleg.
As you can see, that's exactly right. He ran it just like a bootleg. And then he follows his blocking real well. Actually, he went out of bounds right there. He wasn't even really tackled. He was just ran out of bounds. He ran out of real estate.
The punt was 37 yards. The return was 40 yards. So it's at the 16. The toss goes to Van Dyne. He's got a lot of room, and he's in for the touchdown. A 16-yard touchdown run for Craig Van Dyne.
I'd like to say that he earned that one because of the way he ran the return on the punt, and then to come back and give him the ball to score. That just tells me a little bit about the coach. He's talking about how hard these kids work, and it's a reward to be able to do that kind of thing.
Take a look at it again, and look at the great job sealing off that line, the offensive line does.
Blocking is terrific up front. You can't say enough about those people, and Van Dyne really isn't even challenged as he goes in to score.
They fumble the snap on the point after, and Scott Miller is tackled back at the 18-yard line, so the try is no good. John Reels in there to make the tackle on the play, but the holder, Van Dyne, it's the only mistake he made on that whole series, as he didn't come up with a snap from Jerry Cooper.
Well, Tom, you and I were down there. You know it's cold, so it's got to be cold on your hands to be able to handle the football. And in this kind of weather, that football is like a piece of cement. I mean, it's heavy and it's hard.
So Van Dyne gets a 16-yard touchdown after his 40-yard return, getting the handoff from Brad Schmidt. This copyrighted broadcast is presented for the entertainment and non-commercial use of our audience. Any reproduction or other use of this program without the written consent of Sports Channel is strictly prohibited. Tom Stocker, Bill Gorley with you. 4:01 left to go in the first half, as Cole City leads by the score of 20-6, and the versatility and the scope of this attack for Cole City has been impressive, Bill.
Well, on that particular scoring play, they ran a wing formation. They just outflanked the defense for the touchdown. So somebody is giving them the right information as far as what they need to run formation-wise, and Carlinville hasn't made those adjustments.
This will be a big drive coming up here for the Cavaliers, as they trail now by 2 touchdowns. They'd like to get a score on the board before halftime. Scott Miller's kick, a squibber, taken at the 35-yard line by Brad Hyatt. And he's out of bounds at the 45. Cole City gambling there, figuring a knuckleball in these kind of conditions might not be a bad little try. But good field position, though, for the Cavaliers at their own 45, first and 10.
Well, I think with the way the wind is blowing, that's not a bad idea, because your chances of getting the ball back would be a lot greater, because it's so slippery and you can't get down to pick up the ball properly. If it's up in the air, the ball actually is coming back because the wind is so strong.
Officials timeout as we have an equipment adjustment. Looks like over there, Brad Skubik is working on Scott Miller. May not be able to get his kicking shoe off. It may be frozen. Let's take a look now at the Cole City scoring drive, which was just a brief 16-yard play by Van Dyne. Took a mere 6 seconds. To give them a 14-point edge, 3:56 to go. That's Call. Sean Call gets the handoff from Meyer. Picks his way up to about the 48. Matt Powell and Tim Mystic, the two outstanding linebackers for Cole City, combined to make the tackle after a gain of 4 yards.
And Carlinville goes to the shotgun formation and then chooses to run out of it with Sean Call running out of the fullback spot after the quarterback handed off.
I think the difference, Bill, may be Cole City has had this varied offense all year long, and I think maybe, from what I've talked to Andy Easton, that maybe Carlinville is trying to do a few things they're not used to doing.
Out of character.
Right.
Here's a screen. Oh, and he dropped the ball.
A screen pass dropped by a wide-open Doug Ryder, the 6-foot junior, and he had real estate to work with down the sidelines.
Definitely. He had a lot of room to be able to run. Plus, he had three blockers out in front.
Let's check in on the sidelines with Joe Passion.
A moment ago, I was talking to Van Dyne down here on the field, on the sideline, asking him about that fake reverse punt, how well he shielded behind his body. I asked him if they practiced the acting part of it during practice. Said, no, as long as the other guy is moving fast and they think he's got the ball, I can slow down and hide it and then make my move upfield. And he did. He's not accepting any nominations for an Oscar at this time. He's just happy to have returned it for 40-plus yards, as well as getting the touchdown to follow. That should give him a good start going into halftime. Back upstairs, guys.
And the winner for the best supporting role in a punt return obviously goes to Mr. Van Dyne. Actually, great job by Miller. Miller had, of course, that, I should say Schmidt. Schmidt had that big catch, of course, to set up their first touchdown. And I said early in this game, I thought he could be a real piece of the puzzle for Cole City, and he has been.
And obviously, he has had some success because he's had a return this year. And I'm sure Carlinville was aware of that, so they wanted to make sure that he wasn't going to get another one on them, and they overplayed him. And Van Dyne, of course, with his acting, did a good job and ended up with another score.
Third and 13 at the 43. Meyer drops the snap, but the defense relaxed just a bit, and he was able to get it up to the midfield stripe and pick up 7 yards, but it'll still be fourth and about seven for the Cavaliers. Tim Mystic forced Meyer out of bounds.
Well, it appears every time that Carlinville goes to the shotgun formation, they spread Cole City out, and they've been able to make a few yards. And here's a good example of it on the replay. He fumbles the ball. Josh Myers fumbles the ball, picks it up, gives him enough momentum, and then he's smart enough to be able to pick it up and just head for open daylight. And then, of course, you've got Tim Vucetich making the play, and he comes up and he saved the possibility of them not getting a first down.
The Colers of Cole City have taken a timeout with 3 minutes and 10 seconds left to go in the first half, as you look on at Coach Ken Miller, who was also at Carthage for 5 years and took them to the Class 1A state finals in 84. They were runner-up that year. His record at Carthage, 38-12, before he went to that young program at Cole City. And there's the veteran, Andy Easton, his second trip to the title game. Started his career back in 1960 at Hillsboro.
It's interesting, both of these coaches have been here before, and they both lost. Carthage in a 1A, and Andy Easton, of course, in 1978 in the 2A.
It's fourth and six, and Carlinville will send in Mitch Wagner to punt. Back deep are Van Dyne to the far side and Schmidt to the near side. He's going to kick it. Boy, the Wagner looked like he had fake in his mind. The punt down at the 20-yard line by the Kohlers. Oh, he had larceny in his heart, did Mr. Mitch Wagner. He thought about it.
Well, he also had enough presence of mind that if he thought he had it, he may have had the green light to go ahead and take it. But as he watched, Coal City started to put a little bit more pressure on, and then he was able to kick the ball because no one from Coal City really rushed him.
So it'll be first and 10 at the 18 as we go down to Joe Passion.
One of the most successful traits of this Coal City team this year has been their two-minute drill. Coach Hallahan, one of the assistant coaches, telling me a moment ago on the sidelines, they want the ball back. They feel they can score with 2.5 minutes left in this half. Back upstairs, fellas.
There's Mystic getting it off to a good start. Just knocked off his feet at the 30-yard line by Ridley. Mystic has been a big weapon, one of many weapons offensively for Coal City this afternoon.
Well, we'll get a chance to see Mystic. He looks like he's going one way and then comes back out and pops out. Now, you can see right there that he was watching his blocking and then made his move to try to get to the outside.
He picked up 12 yards and a first down. It's first and 10 from the 30. 2:19 left in the first half. That's Powell. And he is up to the 32. I think another big difference is, I believe that Carlinville feels they have to use Cole. He is their biggest weapon offensively, while there have been so many other weapons that Coal City can use. They're in their hurry-up two-minute offense, as Joe told us. This will be second and 3. Quick out to Van Dyne.
And there were no backs in the backfield. They wanted to spread Carlinville out to be able to come back to the short side.
Ridley, a good job of a one-on-one tackle on the play. But it's a first down.
And that's good, because if Ridley hadn't made that, it may have been another touchdown, because they were playing man for man and they had everybody out and Carlinville had everybody covered. So if you make a mistake on that one, it could be 6 points down.
Powell's the single setback on first and 10 from the 42. He hammers it right up the middle, and he is hit hard by the All-State linebacker Sean Call. Joe Bula, Doug Ryder also in there to help on the top.
Now, this is a good example of two fine football players going head-to-head. There's the hit. You saw Sean Call come in there and just put the helmet right where he should, and he actually knocked Matt Powell back.
So Coal City will stop the clock with a minute 27 left to go in the first half. As you see, Sean Call, the 6-foot senior, 2-year all-conference, named All-State this year. And that's another 2-year all-conference performer you see in the backside, number 79, Joe Bula, who also was a pretty tough wrestler during the wintertime. Right now you see he and the Cavaliers are wrestling with a 14-point deficit with just under a minute and a half to go in the first half. And if Coal City is able to put together an excellent two-minute drive here and put another score on the board, Carlinville is going to have to really regroup in a hurry at halftime.
Andy Easton, the coach for Carlinville, said earlier in the year he really didn't want to play Sean Call both ways. He would like to have him maybe play defense and have somebody else play fullback, and because he felt that he couldn't do both.
Second and 8 from the 44. Quick out to Mystic. Oh, what a stiff arm on Sam Rhodes to get him up to the 45, 46-yard line, get a couple of yards. Rhodes was there to drop him for a loss. But, oh, boy, did Mystic lay a forearm right into Sam Rhodes.
Well, we'll get a good example. Mystic, I think, is a kind of an unsung hero. He does a lot of things and does them well. And here's a good example of how he can run. And he used that arm very well to shed himself. And then, of course, is run out of bounds by the All-State linebacker, Sean Call.
Third down, 8 yards to go at the 44. A middle screen to Mystic. He has a first down and then some to the 43-yard line. Joe Bula makes the tackle. Of course, you've got Joe Bula and his brother Jeff. Taylor made for the Ivy League. You'd have the Bula defense.
Well, here we go with that two-minute offense that Joe Passion talked about. All receivers out, no backs in.
On first and 10, that one sails right by Mystic. He was right in between Mitch Wagner as well as middle guard Doug Ryder. That drop off the line in that pass coverage.
That looked like what you generally call a fire play.
You usually call that, have everybody line up real quick. You try to throw the ball, and if it's not open, it goes down, but at least you haven't wasted a down trying to get some more yardage.
Second and 10 from the 43, just over a minute now for the second quarter. Quarterback draw. Brad Skubic, who hasn't run a lot this year, is able to get the ball to the 38-yard line. He picked up five. It'll be third and five coming up. He was tackled by Joe Bula, but Brad Skubic, who played as a defensive back last year, doing a great job engineering this offense, taking over where his cousin Kurt left off after the previous 2 years.
It's another good example of that formation that we saw. We saw three receivers down here just below us in the booth, and then we saw two receivers wide out the other way. And, of course, they're trying to spread Carlinville out, make them go man-to-man, and Skubic, he has the option on that, either to run the draw or to be able to throw whoever he feels is open. And if the linebackers are out, why, he's got the option to be able to run the quarterback draw.
Some quick repairs there on linebacker Sean Call. Sean's the type, though, just rub a little snow and ice into it, I'll be ready to go. There's Ken Miller. Had a very, a 1-8 start in his career at Cole City. But now he has his team not only in the playoffs for the seventh straight year, but in the title game and leading by 14 late in the first half.
Well, he's got 25 losses, so you figure he's only lost 17 since that very first year, Tom.
Third and five. And Skubic puts it up for grabs. And it's incomplete at the 14-yard line. Ridley battling Brad Schmidt for the ball on the near sidelines. That was just a basic basketball jump ball. Up for grabs as Ridley did a good job. I tell you what, despite his diminutive size, he's not afraid to mix it up in there.
No, he's one of the reasons why Coach Easton feels he wants to come back, because he's very high on this Ridley boy.
And a sophomore class.
Well, he's got a good sophomore class. He's got six people coming back from offense and defense that are all underclassmen.
Skubic throwing. Oh, my goodness. What a tackle by the free safety, Mitch Wagner, as he separated Corey Wingertner from the football. That was a major league lick.
That's the second time that he's done that to Corey Wagner. Let's get a look at this hit. This has got to be one of the better ones that we're going to see all day. There's the catch, and there's the hit. I mean, he really disassembled. And there's a good angle where you see that over-the-head catch, and you can't see the defender coming in. And Wagner really labeled him.
He did a great job breaking on the ball. He read the quarterback all the way. And that was a heck of an effort just to get to the ball for tight end Corey Wingertner.
Yeah, but then they have a surprise that you get hit by the train.
Timeout called by Carlinville. Ken Miller said, we probably don't throw to the tight end as much as we should. And Corey said, that time you threw once too often.
Well, anyway, he's got the number of Mitch Wagner, number 40. What a hit. Hammered him. Woo.
That's a good sign, though, for the Cavaliers, despite the fact they're down by 14. They know this is a big drive here. If they can keep the Kohlers off the scoreboard, they're still very much in this game. If they can get something going early, the big thing is going to be, of course, is that Cole City deferred the option to the third quarter. They'll very likely start the second half with the football.
Well, Carlinville's offense, they've been going a lot of times when they run out of that shotgun formation, they'll go trips to the field, three receivers to one side, and then as Cole City, they have to adjust, and then Carlinville comes back and they attack to the weak side of that formation. So let's see if they try to do that again with the idea that they can still maybe throw the football.
Unusual situation for Carlinville's defense. They gave up 18 points to Paxton Buckley Loader last week, but prior to that, they had held the opponent to 8 points or less in the previous 11 games. Now that fourth down, Carlinville has it, first down. That's Ridley. That's as wide open as he's been all day as he's up to the 45-yard line.
And Brad Skubic comes in to make the tackle and maybe save the possibility of a score. You have to really be impressed with Ridley, and we'll get a chance to maybe get to see what else he can do, because he's really done a lot of things for us today.
17 yards on Ridley's running play is Josh Meyer with time. And that is intercepted and dropped by Dirk Morris. He had it and could not hang on to it. That would have been their second of the day and their 30th of the year. Again, that Cole City defense coming into this game third on the IHSA all-time interception list. with 28 entering today's action.
Well, we'll get a chance. They have great anticipation when the ball's in the air. They have a real presence knowing where they are and where the receivers are. And there's a good example where Dirk Morris comes into the picture when he looked like the receiver was wide open.
Second down and 10. 22 seconds left to go in the second quarter. Meyer throwing it out. He finds Ryder. Ryder's to Cole City's 35-yard line. They picked up 10, and he has an apparent first down. Skupik in there on the tackle for Cole City.
That was almost a screen, like it was up the field. It was like 10 to 12 yards. We'll get a chance to see this. And it's really a screen pass, but it's downfield where they're throwing the screen pass. You see the two linemen coming down to come out on the halfback, and then, of course, you've got the back coming in behind them.
But I think that because that screen was downfield, I think you had ineligible receivers downfield on the play.
there's a good call, isn't it?
That's why that screen looked to be so far downfield, is that there were a couple of linemen way down in the briar patch, way downfield.
Well, you generally have to wait till that ball's in the air before you can release to be able to run that screen. And they looked like they were going down to catch the ball.
No loss of down. It's a 5-yard penalty, so it's second and 15. Meyer again to throw. That's John Reels. Hit at the 37, gets to the 35-yard line, but 5 seconds remain. Tim Mystic makes the stop for Cole City.
I'm amazed that Carlinville, which is an option football team, has gone to the shotgun, has done as well as they have against the shotgun, and they've really not shown any option today at all, Tom.
So Cavaliers will take their final first half timeout as we watch the play again.
And there's the pass, and it's right over the middle, and Josh Myers looks like he feels right at home running that type of offense.
That's how open you can get, Bill, when you're going against a prevent defense.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah, all they want to do is keep in front, and sometimes you look real good statistic-wise when you have the two-minute drill, because people just say, you know, we don't care how many yards you get, just keep them in front of us.
You saw Andy Easton there for a moment. He has Carlinville in the playoffs for the 13th time. He had a 5-year stretch from 82 to 86. That team was 43-8. In fact, three previous times, he's taken an undefeated team into the playoffs.
No question that he has had a great coaching career, and you can certainly see now why someone would want to think twice about retiring, because he's got a very young football team and would like to come back.
Spread motion, that was Paul going in motion. Dropping back, the pass thrown wide of Mitch Wagner as he came back off the line.
Tom, I'm sorry to interrupt you, but it looks like a double pass.
Yeah.
They were looking to throw the ball downfield, and Matt Powell, Sean Paul, had started up the field, and he looked like he would be the intended receiver, but obviously they couldn't get it off.
So at halftime of the Class 2A state title game, it is Cole City leading by 14 points. An interesting series of events there at the very end where Cole City on that two-minute drive, Bill, they were looking to bust this game wide open if they could. In Carlinville's defense, they had to have that series to keep the Kohlers from adding to their lead and giving the Cavaliers a shot in the second half down by two touchdowns.
Well, as you pointed out, of course, when you play a prevent, a lot of things look good, but you've got to be able to keep those people in front of you. You can let them have a lot of yards, but you just can't let them have the score. Let's go down to Joe, and I see he's got Coach Easton down on the field.
All right, thanks very much, Bill. Coach Easton, you look at a first half, some things went well, not enough did. What kind of adjustments do you look during this halftime period?
Well, hopefully we just quit making silly mistakes, mental mistakes on offense. We're in the wrong sets, and I don't know if it's nerves or excitement or what, but we've helped them out quite a bit.
I'll tell you, some great hitting going on, though, by your defensive secondary.
Well, they've been known to do that, and they've coughed up the ball a couple times, but we can't get no sustained offense going again.
So just cut down the mistakes, but you don't see anything changing in your game plan?
No, we got to shut down their outside game. They're hurting us with their streak to the outside, but mostly this first half is our mental mistakes in our offensive sets.
All right, Coach, we'll see you out here in the second half.
All right, thank you.
Thanks so much, Andy. And when we come back, we'll take a look at the highlights of the first half, and then later on, send you back to our Sports Channel studios up in Chicago for more sports highlights throughout the nation. And we'll be back to Hancock Stadium with more of the Class 2A State Championship football game after this timeout. Here at halftime at Hancock Stadium on the campus of Illinois State University, the boys class 2A football championship games at the half. And right now the Kohlers leading the Cavaliers 20-6 here at the break. Joe Passion back with you. Sunshine glimmering in from the skies up above, but very chilly temperatures here in the lower 20s. Highlights, well, they started out with some big plays, and the big plays started out with the Kohlers, and like the 1A game we saw earlier this morning, it started out very early in the ball game. We take a look at some of these highlights now, and you see the big plays. Despite the ice, they were able to get the ball up in the air and find some big plays, and that helped getting a score in early on. The Kohlers got the first score on the board, and then also came back and played some good enough defense to get the ball back. As we can see them running in the ball, one thing that they've been able to do is Miller goes in, but Carlinville came right back and were able to get the football in on a 4-yard out score and bring the ball game at that point within a touchdown. But then watch the reverse on this punt and the great fake made by Van Dyne. He's looking all over, then all of a sudden he's got the near sidelines, 40 yards. He goes down the near sidelines, and then one play later from 16 yards out, Van Dyne goes in for the touchdown, and that led to our score here at halftime, 20-6. Cole City leading Carlinville here at the break of this Class 2A state championship game. And of course, we have more state championship football coming from Hancock Stadium. But after this timeout, stay with us. A warm Steve Cashel is in our Sports Channel studios up in Chicago, and he'll have other sports highlights for you. And we'll be back here with the second half from Normal, Illinois after these timeouts.
Welcome back. It's halftime of the 2A title game, and you can see the Kohlers of Cole City with a 2-touchdown lead over Carlinville. Take a look at the first half statistics and see how they stack up. As you would think, obviously slanted to Cole City side, 11 first downs, passing yards. Cole City is able to get close to the century mark already, just 16 yards for Carlinville. Total yards, about a 2-1 margin there, Bill. Over 200 yards for Cole City. Turnovers even, and time of possession, ironically, in favor of Carlinville by a couple of minutes.
One of the things I have to feel very strongly about, and at the end of the half, Joe Passion was talking with Coach Andy Easton, and he said that they were making a lot of mistakes in some of the sets. I got to believe that he changed types of things that he did and how he wanted to prepare for this football game. I get the feeling that they came out of the offense that they do so well. They had to make some adjustments. And then, of course, you've got the freezing elements. And I just don't think that they've adjusted real well to what their game plan was for this particular game.
On the front end, Andy Easton told me, he said, we cannot get in just a physical match one-on-one with Cole City. We cannot win by hammering Sean Call into the gut of their defense 30 times in a game. So he felt he had to go do some things. But yet he said, we work on passing in our practices. We just haven't had to use them. We're not normally a passing team. But he just felt that he had to make some changes to give himself a little bit of an edge. What they haven't been able really to do was establish an outside game to open up the middle for Call.
Well, and the other thing, Cole City has been utilizing four deep receivers, and they're challenging Carlinville's three deep zone. I think you have to look to to Mitch Wagner, number 40. He's made some great hits, and he's Carlinville in the game, as far as I'm concerned, and the adjustments or lack of adjustments that Carlinville has had to make in terms of what they wanted to do offensively has really hurt them, and yet they're not that far out of the football game.
And you can see a snowy day in Normal Town as we're getting ready for second half action in our 2A title game with Cole City leading by 14.
Well, as the Cole City marching band moves off the field and the players come back onto the field here at Hancock Stadium, halftime of our Class 2A football championship game, and a 20-6 lead for the Kohlers over the Cavaliers. Joe Passion back with you. We'll be joining Tom and Bill momentarily for the second half kickoff. The roar of the crowd is for the Kohlers coming back onto the field and looking for their first undefeated season. Now remember, this is a Cole City team that was back here back in 1984 on this field, and they won the second place trophy at the time. And here's Coach Miller, very well timing. Ken, tell us a little bit about the halftime and what type of adjustments you want to try and make considering how the condition of the field is actually improving.
Well, right now our offensive line is doing a nice job of pass blocking and run blocking. We just can't self-destruct with some of the penalties when we get in the red zone. That was the one concern we had. And the penalty on the field goal hurts a little bit, but our kids are bounced back. We did a nice job of running the ball, and I think that set up our play action pass game. So we've got to keep doing that. We've got to keep trying to be aggressive and try to move the ball, move the chains, and not really trying to worry about the big home run, but just move the chains down the field.
Football has always been a game, at least successful football, is a game of deception. It seems as though you and your coaches have done a very good job of putting some acting lessons into some of your players on the screen passes, especially in that middle screen, that reverse punt that Van Dyne took 40 yards. Everyone has a little bit of actor in them when they pull those off well.
Well, they've done a nice job all year, and the kids have certainly been focused and try to do some of the things that we try to teach them. And those are some of the things that we've taught, we've learned from watching other people, and we just kind of take from them. We're great at thieves, coaches are. And the kids have really done a nice job with that.
You know, I'm also seeing the field improving a lot too, Ken. How's that going to help you guys and maybe adding some things that you might have held back on in the first half because of the icy conditions?
Well, the thing we're going to try and do a little bit maybe is run a little bit of more misdirection. If we can do a little bit more misdirection, then we can keep them honest. Maybe it'll help our inside game with Matt too.
Okay, everybody healthy coming out of that first
so
half?
So far, so good.
All right, Coach, go get him.
Okay, thanks.
Have a great second half. Ken Miller is all set, and I brought up a very good point, guys, that I'm sure we'll see in the second half as it develops. Misdirection plays, trying to take the offense and pushing it away from the direction the defense is going and maybe take advantage of the field rather than letting the field take advantage of you. 20-6, our halftime score here. The Kohlers leading the Cavaliers. Let's send it back upstairs to Tom and Bill.
All right, Joe, thank you very much. I'm not sure Cole City has to do that much different because, Bill, they've been able to establish all their different weapons. They've been able to establish the inside game, the running on the outside game. They've been able to establish a passing game with 93 yards. Take a look at the numbers that Powell has put up already in this game. He's averaging 5 yards a carry, including a pair of 5-yard touchdown runs. But I think it's Carlinville that has yet to establish their diversity in attack. They've been able to get call inside, but Ridley has not been a factor outside, and the passing game has been not been very good for them at all.
Well, it'd be interesting to see how Andy Easton, what adjustments he makes, if he continues to want to spread Cole City out and feel that he can't stand up inside and go blow for blow. On the other hand, I have to wonder a little bit why you would want to change if you're Cole City and try and run misdirection. I know that the field right now in some areas has gotten rid of some of the ice, but I still would be very concerned about the footing when you're trying to run misdirection football.
Coming up in Class 3A, it'll be Waterloo against Pontiac. Mike Lederman, Jack McInerney will have the broadcast of that, and then Bill and I will be back for what we think is going to be an outstanding matchup tonight in 4A, Geneseo against Marion Catholic of Chicago Heights, two outstanding powerhouses in 4A. We'll go head-to-head. Something we'll give there. Neither team has lost a game yet this season. As we see now, again, it will be Carlinville kicking off because Cole City won the toss and deferred to the second half. They'll receive and defend the north goal here at Hancock Stadium. And, of course, we've got two more games coming away tomorrow, 5A and 6A, so a big weekend. As always, Thanksgiving weekend here at Bloomington Normal as we crown 6 IHSA state football champions. Anybody who thinks that six classes waters it down, I tell you what, that spreads around the joy. When you see the enthusiasm when you come into the hotels here on Friday and on Thursday night and see all the excitement that really consumes these communities, you know it's been a great thing all these years since 1974, the IHSA playoffs.
Well, you were talking about how it consumes the community. I was at Thanksgiving dinner with some friends that were from Joliet, Will and Mel Schroeder, and they were talking about how excited Cole City was, and just Joliet in general, in fact, because they're so close to Joliet, and the town has really gotten a hold of this. And we saw it earlier when we came in, when the team first came in on the field, all the stands underneath us stood up and were behind Cole City. So it is exciting, Tom.
Mitch Wagner will kick. That's a bouncer, and it is taken by Corey Windgirder, and he was able to advance the ball to about the 43-yard line, and that's where the Kohlers will set up shop to begin the third quarter. First and 10 as they lead by the score of 20-6. Again, they're a very diversified offense led by quarterback Brad Skubic. Matt Powell has been the usual workhorse in the middle, but I think you got to give some real stars to Tim Mystic and Brad Schmidt. Mystic the flanker and Schmidt the wide receiver. They've been big weapons for Cole City. And that is Paul on a little inside handoff, just slamming through the left side of the pile. Drives forward to about the 47. Joe Bula, defensive left end, makes the stop.
Well, when Coach Miller was talking with Joe Passion downstairs, he said he was going to try and go with that misdirection. Right now, they had a little motion, and that's what you generally see. And so maybe he wasn't blowing smoke. Maybe he's really going to go with this misdirection. It'll be interesting to see how the offense unfolds here, Tom.
Second and 7. And that is Mystic. Cuts inside, but now you see this Carlinville defensive line asserting itself a little bit more, as it was Sean Call in there to make the hit along with Joe Bula. Bill Bates also helping on the stop for the Cavaliers, bringing up third down.
Well, Andy Easton has always prided himself on playing defense, and he always feels that if you're going to win a state championship, you've got to win it with defense first. And I'm sure he had a little talk with his people at halftime, because they seem to be a little stronger. They seem to be a little more enthusiastic.
Third and 5. The toss goes to Van Dyne, and they string him out for a gain of only a yard on the play. Sam Rhodes making the stop along with that guy right there, Sean Call.
Ever present, number 31, Sean Call.
Well, in a way, Andy Easton has been a prophet as far as I'm concerned, because he said this year, traditionally, Carlinville has had trouble with power teams. And they did have trouble with that Cole City power in the first half. But a good defensive series here, as the punt is snapped, is fumbled. And the punter looks like he fumbled the ball up to about the 50-yard line. Hula may have recovered. That was Shane Bishore, who... a little Barnum and Bailey juggling act on that cold football. And we'll watch it again.
Right, we'll see on the replay. The ball actually bounced and couldn't be handled. He's trying to get the handle on the ball and then decides he runs. And then as he does, he fumbles the football.
Yeah, Bishore, I should say Bula stripped it.
And Sean Call recovers the ball.
At the 49, great field position for Carlinville. That's Ridley, but he can't get outside, as it's Matt Paul who knocks him off his feet for a gain of, maybe a loss on the play of a yard.
This is a game where you could memorize a few numbers and you'd have all the good players. Here's Ridley where he turns up inside, and there's the ever-present again. We've got Matt Paul, number 44, coming in to make the play.
Call it no gain, second and 10. Ball just on the Cole City side of the midfield stripe. The fake to Johnson, and in trouble is Meyer, as he is dropped back at the 46-yard line. Powell again showing why he is an all-state two-way performer, linebacker and fullback.
And the reason that play didn't work as well, the tight end fell down. So obviously Josh Meyer really wanted to throw the ball. He's not just rolling out to be able to run the football. It looked like he wanted to throw it, but the tight end fell down.
Big third and 15 play. Carlinville would like to take advantage of the field position they got. And that fumble punt snap. Meyer airing it out. Off the fingertips of Mitch Wagner. Double covered on the play, Brad Schmidt. You see him right there, number 14, who has made some big plays offensively, makes a big play defensively there.
Well, you and I talked about the fact that maybe Brad Schmidt would be an effect, but we thought more offense than defense. Here's the throw by Josh Myers, and you'll see a flash come back in, and that was Brad Schmidt, number 14, coming in from his safety spot to take care of the pass.
Mitch Wagner to punt, just got it away, but he was run into, and there'll be a penalty marker down. Punt rolls out of bounds at the 25-yard line, but he was absolutely flattened by Aaron Berger.
He's rough. And that's another kicking break for Carlinville. We'll get the opportunity to take a look at the miscue and the penalty. There he goes to punt the ball, and the ball is already gone. So once it's gone, you're roughing the kicker.
It's a first down, so the drive stays alive thanks to another mistake on special teams for Cole City. It was a similar kind of mistake on a field goal try that missed and enabled Carlinville to get the 6 points they now have in the ballgame. So it's first down, and the ball is at the 39-yard line of Cole City. Here's Call. Slips by two tacklers, still driving down to the 30-yard line. He ran right by two tacklers and then powered his way for a pickup of 9 yards. Tim Mystic made the stop finally.
You have to be impressed with Sean Call, his upper body strength. When you see him run, he uses that forearm and he really can handle people. And he took on two people and made at least another additional 5 yards, Tom, before he came down.
Wagner, you see in the corner of your screen, the lone wideout. Call this time slowed up as he hits the line and is able to drive only to the 29-yard line. Powell, the first one to get to him, along with right tackle Jacob Cruel, their second leading tackler. Also a two-year starter defensively for Cole City. You take a look at Sean Call.
Carlinville tried a short trap and a quick trap. Nobody went down in a three-point stance. They ran it from standing up and thought they could try and catch Cole City. Where they weren't ready with the count.
Well, he got the yardage for the first down, so it's first and 10 at the Cole City 29-yard line. 7:20 left to go in the third quarter. 20-6 in favor of Cole City. Call hit at the line immediately by Scott Miller. Fumble! And I think Cole City's got it. They do.
Yes, they do.
The hit by Scott Miller forced the ball free, and it is recovered by Jerry Cooper at the 30-yard line.
The ball's handed off to Sean Call. It looked like it was a fake, but Sean Call was held when he was tackled, and he couldn't get back to get the ball, and then Cole City recovered the football.
Oh, a drive that might have been for Carlinville. Suddenly now it's at the 30, and Cole City has it as Powell is flattened at the line of scrimmage. Picks up a yard on the play to set up second and 9. Nose guard Doug Ryder makes the stop. But Bill, that's the drive that could have put Carlinville right back in the thick of this game.
Absolutely. And of course, then you see the scenario of all the key players. You see Sean Call, who's been very important to Carlinville, and the turnover. And then, of course, you see Jerry Cooper, who's the All-State tackle, come in and recover the football. So it's the people that you knew you had to count on to come into the game that can make a change. And now Cole City has the ball offensively.
Powell again trying to get outside. Cannot get away from Doug Ryder, who is extremely quick and hard to block. Did a good job moving down the line from his middle guard position to string out the play.
Doug Ryder, the nose guard, will get an opportunity to see number 41, Doug Ryder, come in and make the play. He slanted to the side that Matt Powell was running the football and came in and made the tackle.
The last series and now this series is the best that Carlinville's defense has played so far this game. So they're starting to assert themselves. The offense has got to be able to catch lightning. Third and 9. That is Schmidt going in motion. He's been their big play man. Rolling out is Skubic, looking for Schmidt, and he can't hang on at the 48-yard line, closely covered by Mitch Wagner.
Well, Skubic threw the ball right on the money. It wasn't a matter of that. It was just that there were two defenders on Brad Schmidt, and he just didn't make the catch.
So now Back to punt is Shane Bishore, who averaged 30 yards a punt on 31 punts this year. His longest this year was 58. But he juggled and dropped that last one, which gave Carlinville great field position. Now he gets this one away. It's not very long. He bounces at the 46. Did somebody touch it?
Yes, he did, but I think Carlinville recovered.
Boy, looked like Carlinville touched it early. Brent Davey, I think, touched it, and I believe it was recovering it was John Reels. Reels recovered it, fortunately for the Cavaliers, who start this drive fitting a pretty good field position at the 44-yard line.
Well, again, Cole City not having good field position. And it looks like the Cavaliers are revived.
Carlinville has to do something, though, with the position that they've been handed now. Second straight time they've gotten the ball in great shape. Quick toss out to Ridley, trying to get him outside. Oh, he is hit hard by Schmidt, who stopped him at the 47 for a gain of only three. He flew out of nowhere. That guy has been the player of the game for Cole City.
Yeah, well, you'll get a good chance to see. There's the quick pitch to Ridley on the outside. And now you'll see Brad Schmidt. How he got into all of in between all those blockers, I don't know, but he came in and made the play and made a good one.
72, Spencer Call did a good job. That big 240-pound tackle leading the corner for Ridley, but what a job by Schmidt to dive in there and make the play. And it's second and seven. Ridley, and he's dropped back at the 40-yard line by Jerry Cooper, who was not fooled by all the dipsy-doo in the backfield.
Well, it's amazing to me that Carlinville has chosen not to go straight ahead. That's where their strength is, and now they're doing all of this. And Cole City has great pursuit. Here's a good example. They're just pursuing the football. They're not fooled at all. And the thing about Cole City is they have good team speed. And, of course, I know it's negated a little bit by the field conditions, but they do that very well, and they pursue the ball extremely well.
Indeed, a lot of east-west in this offense for Carlinville. Meyer trying to dump off a screen, and if it was intended for Call, he never turned around to look for the football. He had a couple of blockers downfield, and Yowell, the center, along with Joe Pulda. That was a blown assignment.
Yeah, you see a picture of Coach Easton right there, and he looks like he's really upset with the fact that and frustrated because they just aren't performing the way their capabilities and the way he's talked. And again, they're a young football team.
Mitch Wagner back in punt position. Has plenty of time, an end-over-end kick. Schmidt will field it at the 30. Still alive and steps out of bounds near the 40-yard line, and that's where Cole City will get it back as we will take a break after that 30-yard punt. 4:07 to go in the third quarter. No scoring yet in the second half as Cole City leads in our 2A state title game. Welcome back to Icy Hancock Stadium. Tom Stocker and Bill Gourley with you. Just over 4 minutes left to go in the third quarter. Cole City with the ball leading by 14 points. Skubik looking down for Schmidt. Makes the catch at the 40. Down to the 29-yard line. He got one-on-one coverage with the strong safety John Reels, and was able to burn him for a first down, a 30-yard gain.
Well, just a two-step drop, a fake to the fullback, and he just let Schmidt get out, and all he did was just run a pattern downfield. And you know, you have to talk about two unheralded people, and we'll get to see an angle here where he made a nice catch and just started upfield. But we talked about Schmidt earlier, and we also talked about Mystic, and both of those people have really performed very well today, Bill. Our time.
This is Cole City's third series of the second half, and that was their first down. And on first down there, they get the ball 5 yards to the 25-yard line. So far, it's been a one-sided game through the air. Cole City has been unaffected by the icy conditions here at Hancock Stadium.
And with all the different formations and attempts that Carlinville has made as far as passing is concerned, they still only have 16 yards to show for it, Tom.
Second and five from the 25. That is Mystic trying to work off the lead block of Matt Powell. Powell jumped early but moved forward only one step, which you can do.
Right, and of course, Carlinville wanted him to call that penalty, but
it'd be no different than if he went in motion and then stopped.
But he got himself reset. So it'll be third down and about 4 yards to go on the play. Cole City could perhaps bust this game wide open with a touchdown on this drive. They lead 20-6. Quick pitch back and a great job knifing through the defensive end, Joe Pula, as he knocked Powell off his feet.
And that was an option type pitch, even though there wasn't any option. We'll have the opportunity to see that pitch. He just takes a couple steps down the line and then just pitches the ball because it was a single back and there was no one to fake to the fullback, and Carlinville was not fooled at all.
Oh, what a job by Buller that covered the pitch man. Played his man all the way.
Joe Buller has really played good defense all day.
Loss on the play of a yard. It'll bring a fourth down and 6 yards to go. Out of an eye, play action fake by Skubic. Steps up in the pocket. The receiver fell down and it's intercepted by Wagner.
In the end zone.
Well, no, he's at the 3 yard line.
Look, you know, you can't tell, Tom. It looked to me like he was in the end zone. And then I looked at it again from the camera angle here, and we'll see it on the replay.
I'm not so sure. He should have just knocked the ball
out. Watch the block that Powell makes so that Skubic can step up inside. Knocks his man down, pumps twice, back to throw the ball, and of course it gives a chance for the Carlinville defender to be able to come back in there. And I gotta believe that he thought he was maybe in the end zone also.
Schmidt fell down. The odds are of Cole City nailing a punt inside the five from that angle were pretty slim. Should have just knocked the ball down, but he did get the Oski, and so it's first down. Boy, remember it was just a little while ago that Carlinville had a great field position. Now look where they are.
That's
his
right.
Penalty markers are thrown.
Well, I have to believe dead ball foul.
The mistakes continue to mount up for Randy Easton's ball club.
Well, he's saying they had a timeout, and officials saying no.
1:28 left to go, third quarter, 20-6. In favor of Cole City. They scored the first two times they have the football. Carlinville came out early in this game, looked to be trying to do things they weren't accustomed to, try to a wide attack on an icy field. Turned the ball over in an interception, and very quickly it was turned into Cole City's first touchdown as that pass intended for Reels off his fingertips at the 15-yard line, covered by Brad Schmidt, who has been ever-present throughout this game. John Reels, a three-sport star at Carlinville. Came into the game with 7 receptions on the year. As a team, Carlinville averaged only 60 yards a game passing, so when you see that they come into this game trying to really open things up, it's just not what they had been doing.
Well, it's definitely out of character.
There's Paul just muscling his way up across the 5-yard line. Of course, that tough defense of Cole City.
Well, this is where they're really going to be tough when they're inside that 10-yard line. They're really going to put pressure on. And again, Carlinville has been taking big splits, trying to split that defense up a little bit and try to get inside and then maybe have the possibility where they can get outside, but they haven't been successful being able to do that. There's the big splits there. You get a good example of what they're trying to do.
Josh Meyer back in the end zone. In trouble. He's brought down at the 1-yard line. Powell got to him for the quarterback sack, along with Scott Miller. Hey, there's a guy that back in the game against Carlinville suffered a torn medial collateral knee injury.
There's the fake inside to Sean Call. Now he's in the end zone, sees that he's in trouble and comes out, and he's tackled right at the one by Matt Powell and Scott Miller.
So Mitch Wagner at the end line. A high short punt with the wind at his back. And it takes a Cole City bounce, and it's down at about the 18-yard line. And oh, a great field position for Cole City. A punt of only 17 yards. And
is that a trade-off for field position or what? Carlinville going at the beginning of this quarter was definitely in good field position, and now it's in reverse.
One quarter left in the battle for the 2A state championship. Cole City leads 20-6. Welcome back to Hancock Stadium. Tom Stocker and Bill Gourley with you. One quarter left in the battle for the 2A state championship. And Cole City with a chance to put this one away, perhaps, as they start this drive at the 18-yard line of Carlinville, first and 10.
Well, the fans underneath us certainly are wanting to put it away.
That's Powell down to the 14, maybe the 13-yard line. He doesn't do it flashily. He's not the real big get the yards, you know, 20 yards at a time. He's a hard-working inside, blue-collar kind of guy, Matt Powell.
But he really has some real athletic ability. His ability to catch the ball, be able to run laterally, go straight ahead. He's a real good athlete.
Powell stopped at the 16-yard line, hit by Cole, along with the cornerback Sam Rhodes.
That's about the fifth or sixth time that both those linebacker fullbacks have met, and it's always a standoff.
Lost a couple of yards on the play. It'll be third down and 8 yards to go. The ball just outside the 16-yard line.
You know, Tom, the other thing that's surprising him about Matt Powell is that he definitely has speed. He has a lot more than you think when you look at that big lumbering type of fullback.
He's already scored 2 touchdowns today, third and 8. Reverse, that's Van Dyne. If he gets a block, oh, what a great job by Ridley.
Ridley
fighting through the block, and he took Van Dyne off his feet at about the 22-yard line. Great job.
Well, that was a one-on-one, and he fought off the block, and the replay will show how Ridley came in to make the play. There's the handoff, and we'll watch Ridley where he fights off. There's the play right there. He comes in and makes the play. Shoestring or not, he certainly made a good play. And Jerry Cooper was there too.
Making it, well, Jerry Cooper was leading the block, and Ridley went right through Cooper's block. So it's fourth down. Skubik's gonna go for it all, looking for Van Dyne. Incomplete. He had to turn into pass defender himself and take it away from Ridley. Just outside the goal line, so Carlinville dodges a big-time bullet and gets the ball back on downs and has it first and 10, and they've got to do something in a hurry.
They're just two sequence of plays is certainly a good example of why Coach Andy Easton is so high on Tinge Ridley.
They'll start at the 21-yard line. Carlinville's defense has played much more like itself in the second half. And if the offense had been able to take advantage of the field position, they would be knocking on the door. They're still down by 2 scores, but have to get something. There's a fumble by Paul, and it's recovered by Scott Miller. Miller, the nose tackle. Paul never had it. He was looking downfield before he tucked the ball away.
We might be able to see if he had what difficulties he had with the pitch. No, he went to grab it. Instead of letting the ball come to him, he went to grab it. He was looking for the handle and never found it.
So it's at the 18-yard line.
You know, Tom, when your best person or your best people can't make the play, you know that it might not be your day.
And you saw the third turnover of the game for Carlinville. Skubik looking to throw. He's got a one-on-one coverage down there on Schmidt. Incomplete. As Schmidt had Wagner one-on-one, but the pass just a little thrown behind Brad Schmidt.
That's the third big play that Mitch Wagner has made, and we'll get a good example. There's a fake by Skubik. He gets some depth, throws the ball. He knows he's going to Schmidt, and there's a good example of the play that Mitch Wagner has made all afternoon.
Well, Schmidt, very athletic, basketball, baseball player as well. In fact, his dad is the baseball coach and the girls' basketball coach. And he went all the way up there to try to haul that one in. Second down. Again, Skubik to put it up. Looking for Mystic, and it's intercepted in the end zone by Sam Rhodes. 25th interception of the year. In fact, check that. Second of the day, 26th of the year for Carlinville's defense. Let's go down to the sideline and our colleague, Joe Passion.
Well, despite Carlinville defense coming through with a big play here, This is the big quarter for the Kohlers. The fourth quarter, as you can see. Now, they were holding up the four fingers at the fourth quarter. That's the rallying point for the final period of play, the fourth and the quarter. So for Tom upstairs and Bill, here's our quarter for your thoughts.
Guys, go to the snack machine, would you, and to see if you can get some chips for after the game. First down at the 20-yard line, and you can see trying to get everybody fired up there was Corey Windgarner, the right end after he makes the play, bringing up second down and about 15 yards ago as he threw him for a 5-yard loss.
Well, with the score 20-6 and the Kohlers up, you know, I could see why you might want to throw the ball up and try and put the game away. On the other hand, to come back again, you know, run the clock down. I think that's the key right here.
Just under 9 minutes left in the fourth quarter. Josh Meyer rolls out, being chased. Now he's in trouble. He is hit from behind at the 15-yard line by Scott Miller, and he has become a real force in this game in the second half.
Well, as you mentioned, Scott Miller had a torn medial ligament problem, and we'll get a good example of Scott Miller here. He handles a man, and he comes. I don't know that he had that much problem with his knee because he came from behind to make that tackle on Josh Meyer.
As a testimony to modern medical science and Miller's toughness, after suffering a torn medial collateral ligament in his knee, he missed only 4 weeks. That used to end careers, folks. Meyer rolls out left, and the pass nowhere close to Wagner. And right now, Carlinville's offense is really, really sputtering.
There's Coach Easton, and you know he's not very happy with what's happening. I just feel that at this point that they're trying kind of a grab bag offense right now, trying to see what will work and what will be able to get them back. Early in the third quarter, they had some good field position, had an opportunity, as you pointed out, Tom, to be able to maybe get back in this football game.
They have the ball out near midfield to start a couple of drives, but couldn't do anything with it. Boy, the wind knocked that punt down from Mitch Wagner. And Cole City will just let it roll out of bounds at about the 33-yard line. And Cole City has been trying, but they have not been able to put Carlinville away.
Well, you know, when you say put them away, at this point, Carlinville really hasn't done much offensively. They're down 20-6. At this point, do you throw the football or do you try and run the football, try and get your first downs and run the clock down? I guess maybe I'm a little more conservative, but at this point, I don't think I'd want to throw the football and take that chance. I think I'd want to keep it on the ground, run it straight ahead, not misdirection, get good footing and try and just take up and eat up the yardage and eat up the clock at the same time.
Just under 8 minutes left to go. That is Mystic, Tim Mystic. The 5'11 senior hammers off left tackle Sean Call in there to make the initial stop for the Carlinville defense. Rob Yowell, the right end, also coming up to assist down the play.
You know, Tom, if you had to pick most valuable players today, I think I would look to, if it was Cole City anyway, Mystic and Schmidt. I think they both played an outstanding football game and contributed in a lot of different areas.
Well, you knew Powell was going to be his usual effective self. There's a question as whether the other offensive weapons would be effective for Cole City. There is Mystic getting corralled at the 30, a loss of a yard on the play. Joe Pula, the 2-year all-conference left end, makes the stop for the Cavaliers.
Well, I don't think they've not just been only effective as far as offense has been concerned, but both of them have been very active defensively as well. And I think probably they maybe contributed more defensively than they did offensively, and that's what impressed me about both of those young men, Mystic and Paul Schmidt.
From Paul City, I've seen a very impressive, well-rounded game on both sides of the football.
Right.
Third down. Here's Van Dyne. Strung out as he gets to the 27-yard line, a gain of only two, bringing up a fourth down. And with 6:24 left to go, I'm sure Carlinville, I should say Cole City, probably feels they, being up by two touchdowns, could go for it on fourth down here. Fourth and a long 4 yards to go. They know if they score here, they could bust this game right open at the seams.
Well, he's got a lot of confidence in his defense, and they're going to go for it.
Boy, there's an off. There's a formation we haven't seen yet today. Full house backfield. Van Dyne, no. Short of the first down. And Carlinville dodges another bullet. But, boy, time really working against the Cavaliers. Now 5:50 left, and they need two touchdowns.
The Cole City people went to the wide side of the field, and we'll maybe get an example. It's an unbalanced line. They put all their strong people to one side to be able to run it, and Carlinville did not come up and adjust to that formation. It looked like it was a tight inside, but then they went with a wide receiver out there plus a wing, and it was an unbalanced line.
From the 21, it's first and 10. There's Powell. Knocked off his feet. He coughed up the football, but he fumbled it out of bounds. And that is perhaps inside the five. And that is the first down since that 30-yard pass back at the end of the third quarter.
Here's the versatility of what we're looking at, Matt Powell. Where I said before that he had the speed, he turned it up. He ran laterally, turned it up, and then there was an excellent hit.
He fumbled it in bounds.
And it was an excellent hit. And by John Reels, and he coughed up the football, but the ball went out of bounds. But
it's a touchback, so it'll be first down for Carlinville.
Right. And it was an excellent run by Matt Powell. John Reels saves the day. Gives Carlinville another shot at it.
There's a quick out to Wagner, a flip to Ridley. Little flea flicker at the 26-yard line. We have not had a first down since that 30-yard pass at the end of the third quarter. Neither team has been able to get anything going in this fourth quarter.
We've got to talk about this flea flicker because it's really a hook and ladder time. You know, here's the pass, and he's waiting in there. Oh, now we're back to play here, so we didn't get a chance to see it.
I saw the hook. We missed the ladder. Pass knocked out, incomplete, inside the 30-yard line.
All right, we'll get to see the flea flicker, or better yet, the hook and ladder right here. There's a throw by Josh Myers. He's looking to see if the defensive player comes, and there's the ladder. That's the part we missed. But it's an excellent football play, and it can work. If you got a dry field, it's excellent. It worked there, but didn't get as many yards as you expect.
Third down at the 4-yard line. Josh Meyer rolls out to buy some time, has time, and throws it away. It'll bring up fourth down. And let's head down to the sidelines where Joe Passion has been patrolling throughout the game.
Well, very briefly, I just talked to Ken Miller down here on the Cole City sideline, and you saw how effectively the defense that attempt the hook and ladder play, and he kind of smiled. He said, we've been working on that all week. Our players knew it would be coming based on the formation, and he just laughed and very proud of how his defense is holding on here in this late moments of the fourth quarter. Back upstairs, guys.
I feel like I'm watching backdraft.
See, the thing is, Tom, is the older guys call it the hook and ladder. The younger guys call it something else.
Razzle dazzle.
That's exactly right. That has never changed.
Meyer, it's complete. Over the middle to John Reels. Hit and knocked down immediately at the 35-yard line by Rover Dirk Morris. It was a fourth down play. They get the first down to keep this drive alive. It's do or die now, obviously, for the Cavaliers. 4:48 left to go in the game. They trail by 14. There has been no scoring in the second half. Out of a shotgun, Josh Meyer unloads it, but right to Powell. Threw it right to him at the 40. And he's out of bounds near side after he returns at 5 yards, and that may be the final nail in the Cavaliers' coffin.
He just didn't have enough arm strength to be able to throw that ball. And Matt Powell was in his zone, and it was just like it was thrown directly to him.
Third interception of the game for Cole City. They now have 31 on the year.
Here's Josh Myers trying to throw the ball at least 20 yards, and he, of course, was attacked, so he really couldn't get the ball off, and that's why he didn't have this arm strength, but he also tried to throw it flat-footed. And there's Matt Powell making the interception and going out of bounds, sliding.
Cole City still needs four, though, to reach second in the all-time IHSA interception list. They're four behind Belleville Althoff, who had 35 in 1990. Simple running play up the middle, under 4.5 minutes.
Another good example of strength that Matt Powell has. He took on the tackler and still kept his body. Took him on and took him for at least 2 or 3 yards.
We have talked about all the offensive weapons for Cole City, but I tell you what a job the Kohlers defense has done this afternoon. Carlinville's offense has not had a chance to get organized at all.
No, and I think when you see the statistics when it's all said and done, I think it'll show.
Here is Mystic, hit by Call at the 30, and he drives inside of the 29-yard line. Tim Mystic, one of the big heroes today, along with Craig Van Dyne, Brad Schmidt, Matt Powell, of course, offensively. Scott Miller defensively, Brad Schmidt defensively.
Jerry Cooper defensively.
Yep. Tell you what, tough afternoon for that individual, Sean Call. What a year he has had on both sides of the football, and a tough way to end his career this afternoon. But he did lead his team to the title game.
Not many teams can say that.
Van Dyne strung out on the play by Sam Rhodes. Drops him for a loss back at the 35 for a loss of 6.
This is what makes high school football so much fun. The clock is ticking down, you're losing 20-6, and you see people still playing defense just as tough now at the end of the football game as they did at the beginning of the football game.
Under 3 minutes, as you see on your screen. Greg Van Dyne, versatile two-way performer for the Kohlers. They send Schmidt, the lone wide out, to the upper right corner of your screen. And
offense.
Somebody in the neutral zone. Because there was still time left on the play clock. That's James Krug there, 76, big right tackle. Take good job done by not only the two big tackles, Krug and Krul, but that early burst there by that center, Shane Bishore, showed that he was going to be a factor in today's game, even though he's rather undersized per center, but played well above his 155 pounds.
Now, will we see a punt?
It is fourth down. And this is Shane Bishore. He can't come up with that snap. He's in trouble. Throws it incomplete in the direction. Threw it in the direction of Ricky Ferrara. But that will go over to Carlinville on downs.
But that was quick thinking, because he would have lost 20 yards if he hadn't done that time.
So we've got a break in the action. Folks huddled up against the chilly temperatures in Bloomington Normal. 20-6 with time running out here in the 2A title game. Still to come your way, Mike Lederman, Jack McInerney will bring you Waterloo and Pontiac for the 3A title. And then tonight on Sports Channel Plus Live at 7, it'll be the 4A title battle, Geneseo and Chicago Heights Marion. On a first down play, the swing out to Mike Johnson, and he is into Cole City territory. He is at the 42-yard line, and they're still not out of the woods yet, but boy, they've got to get a score on the board in a hurry.
And then hope for a miracle after that.
Onside kick. I'd like your chances for an onside kick recovery in these kind of conditions.
Yes, excellent. Would certainly be good.
But first things first, Meyer rolling out. Now runs as the pocket collapses. Good job has been done by Cole City secondary, because Meyer has not had anybody to throw to. And by the time that he decides he's going to run the football, the offensive line just can't sustain the blocks anymore against the bigger defensive line of Cole City.
And that's a good example of he's had to hurry his throws. He hasn't had the time to be able to pick out the receivers that he wants. And of course you've got Cooper, Krug, Krull, Weingartz, Miller, all those people up front that have really been in the face of Josh Meyer all afternoon.
But again, a lot has to do with that secondary coverage. Andy Easton was planning on calling it quits this after his 33rd year of coaching, his 18th at the helm of Carlinville. And he's from Gillespie.
But you know, he's a he's a competitor, and he's going to walk out of the stadium if they don't win, and he's going to say, I need one more shot at this. And with all those people coming back, I'm sure he's going to reconsider.
Yeah, he lives down in Gillespie. Don DeBrino, of course, brought the Miners here a couple of years ago in this two-way title game. Second down, and Meyer has nowhere to go. All the way back to the 46-yard line as he is sacked by Jacob Krull, the 6'6", 225-pound senior defensive end.
And that was just one of the many defensive linemen that we've talked about.
And a timeout call by Carlinville. Watches as the protection breaks down.
Right, and what I was just going to say is, Carlinville is choosing some deep routes rather than go to the intermediate. They got to throw the short ones before they can get the long ones, and they're trying to get that big score right away.
You know, you hear coaches talk about, we're not going to change anything. We're going to dance with what brung us. I really think that Andy Easton had the right idea in trying to open up his offense, because you knew that with the size mismatch that they could not hammer call inside for 30 times and win the football game. The conditions played against them. Obviously, they were unaccustomed to what they were doing by lining up in wrong formations. And never could get their offense in gear.
Well, he didn't hide that at the beginning of the year. At the beginning of the broadcast, so we talked to him on a teleconference. He said right then he couldn't stay in there and hit with the Cole City. There's Josh Myers now running for his life.
That's as big a run as Josh has been able to turn in running out of that particular situation to about the 43-yard line, but the clock keeps ticking. A minute 33 left to go in the fourth quarter. And another timeout for Carlinville, and that should be the last one they have available.
If you were able to just take the plus yardage that Josh Myers made from running around, he'd probably have more rushing yards than anybody else on that Carlinville team. Of course, you have to take the minuses, so he obviously won't end up that way. But he's actually made some long runs, longer than anybody else today is for Carlinville.
The future may be on the sideline still for Carlinville, 33 underclassmen. However, for Cole City, this has been the compilation or the final step in a quest for this team. This is an all-senior defensive team. And you look at their starters offensively, they're all seniors there. So this has been the final chapter for a team that started as freshmen. And with their freshman-level games, their sophomore-level games, who have won 42 of 44 and about to make it 43 of 45.
And the only games they lost were last year, and then they lost in the semifinals.
Minute 33 left. Fourth down. This could be it for Carlinville. Fourth and 11. A spread formation. Meyer over the middle. Caught by Reels. Still on his feet, dropped the football, and Cole City's got it, and that should do it. Cole City recovers with a minute 26 left to go. Reels was trying to run for extra yardage after the catch. He was stripped of the football, and Cole City comes up with, that is the fourth turnover of the game, or fourth takeaway of the game for Cole City's defense.
And there's Josh Myers back to throw the ball. And this is kind of ironic justice to the whole game situation, because this is the type of frustration that Carlinville has had the whole football game. They're not a team that turns the ball over. They play it very close to the vest, and there's a good picture of frustration on Andy Easton's face.
Quarterback Brad Skupik just goes down to one knee, 59 seconds left. Cole City about to complete an undefeated season in only its 16th year of varsity football competition. And again, go back to the start of the broadcast. This is Andy Easton's 18th year as head coach at Carlinville. They had undefeated teams back in the mid-40s and an undefeated team in 66 long before the playoffs came into being in 74 as Skubik goes down to one knee. Cole City was known as a baseball and a basketball town.
The Colors. And there you see the 2A champions, Cole City, and there's Coach Miller going out.
18 seconds to go. Ken Miller's going to come across the way. and seek out Andy Easton.
Well, that's what it's all about, Tom, right there. That's the one thing you miss when you're not coaching anymore is the camaraderie that you have with your players and with opposing coaches as well as with your coaching staff.
And there they are, the 2A state champions from Cole City. Back with the awards assembly here at Hancock Stadium for the 2A title game after we take this timeout. Cole City wins it 20-6.
Back here down on the field at Hancock Stadium, the Class 2A champions have been crowned, or actually will be officially crowned here, a 20-6 winner for the Kohlers of Cole City. And they go 14-0 for the first time in school history and will pick up their first place trophy. But for a great team on a great year, let's watch the Cavaliers of Carlinville and Coach Andy Easton and his captains receive their second place trophy. Remember earlier in the year, Carlinville hosted this Cole City team, lost in a very hard-fought game, promised themselves that they would be back to take on this team at Hancock Stadium, and even though it was early in the year, that prophecy became true, and despite being on the losing end for the second time this season, a great, great tribute to this football team from Carlinville to be in the championship game and to have another shot at this outstanding Cole City team that hasn't lost a game all year long. And this gentleman right here, after over 30 years as head coach, saying he will step down, but I thought Tom Stocker brought up a very valid point. He's got a lot of these kids coming back next year, and you have to wonder, he may not be thinking about it right now, but he might when he thaws out about coming back one more time and bringing these kids back here next season. Upstairs now, let's join Phil Gorley and Tom Stocker.
All right, Joe, thank you very much. As our 2A champion has been crowned, Cole City finishes off an undefeated season this year at 13-0. When you take a look at it, the first time these two teams met, it was one in the first half, 7-0, a late second quarter touchdown by Cole City. Same thing happened today. Cole City scored the first two times they had the football, and that's all they would need.
Well, in the rematch, in the first ball game, there was only one drive, and that was when Cole City won it. And, of course, Carlinville knew at this point that they could not stand in there and face up to them man-to-man and came into this game trying to be diversified.
All right, let's go down to the field and join our trophy presentation ceremony.
A special medallion is presented to Mr. Thronberg, and the individual awards will be presented to Coach Miller and his team captain by Mr. Stinson. Championship Class 2A team trophy will be presented to the Kohlers of Cole City, who finished the season with a final record of 14 wins and no losses. Presenting the championship trophy will be Mr. Stinson. Mr. Stinson, if you please.
So the Kohlers raise the trophy high
the Class 2A championship game
as they win first ever in their school's history state football championship, capping off a 13-0 run with an impressive win, putting it together here on the field of Hancock Stadium. Coming up, we will visit with their victorious head coach Ken Miller and have more after we take this timeout in the IHSA Class 2A state football championship. The Kohlers of Coal City have been crowned our 2A state champion here in our second battle on Hancock Stadium's frozen turf. Let's go down to the turf now, where Joe Passion has a very happy Ken Miller.
Well, 1984, second place wasn't good enough for Ken Miller. He had to come back here and get the biggest trophy of all. Congratulations, undefeated season and a state championship to go with it. A great season for you.
Well, thank you very much. You know, 9 years ago we got here and really we didn't really enjoy ourselves that much. And we didn't take time to have fun in the state championship. And I think our kids, not only just because we won, but we took a time to look around and appreciate the crowd that we had. And then we really came out and played Kohler football, I thought, all day today.
Well, it looked like half of Coal City came out here today. I don't think anything would be working in the town. I doubt there's many shops open. It seems like they're all here at Hancock Stadium. And I saw here on the sidelines the players fed off that.
Yeah, I think so. And, you know, they have all year. Our fans have been outstanding all year long, following us throughout the playoffs. We've had great crowds when we went to Watsika and going went to Seneca. And it's just been that way all throughout. And, you know, we turned this thing around about 7 years ago. And we've been to playoffs now 7 years in a row, and our following is in the fall has just been outstanding.
Bill Gorley and Tom Stocker upstairs got a question for you, Ken. Go ahead, guys.
Yeah, Ken, this is Tom Stocker. You know, we knew coming in that Powell was going to be, as usual, all-state self, but I thought your other weapons today, especially Mystic and Schmidt, were really big factors today.
Well, I thought so, too. You know, Brad made the catch there to set the second touchdown. And, you know, I think our defense deserves a lot of credit, too. They've done a great job throughout. And we mix it up. We've, you know, when they've tried to take away the inside game with Matt, you know, we've tried to be able to throw the football, and we were able to do that today. And Brad Skubik stuck in there. And I think our offensive line, when we had to run the ball, they opened some holes for us. And then when it came to pass block, it got some Brad some time too.
All defense in the second half, and that was enough to hold on for this 20-6 win.
Well, yeah, our defense has just played outstanding. You know, we had 8 seniors coming back from last year, and we're a senior-dominated group, and, you know, we put a lot of heart in our defense, and championships are usually won with the defensive side of the football.
That's right, and congratulations to Ken Miller and his ball club. I do want to warn you before I send it back upstairs, I talked to Andy just a few moments ago. He had told a lot of people he would retire after this year, and I asked him, with all his kids coming back, could there be another Carlinville matchup against Coal City again next year? And he goes, I don't have to make a decision until February. Wait till I thaw out. I might thaw out by then. Congratulations. You might see him again.
Well, thank you, Joe. And I'll tell you what, they run a class program. They really do. And they were so hospitable to us when we came down there the second week of the season. And their kids, you know, nothing but praise from our kids about how they play. They just play hard. Hard-nosed football, and then, you know, they'll knock you down and then pick you back up and pat you on the rear end, and here we come again. And it's a tribute to Coach Easton and his program that he has.
Enjoy the championship, Ken.
I will.
All right, guys, back up to you.
All right, thank you very much, Joe. You know, Coal City scored the first two times they had the touchdown today, when it looked like perhaps that Carlinville was coming out, trying to do something obviously it wasn't accustomed to. The first play was a wide running play. Their second play, a pass play on the icy conditions, was intercepted. Two plays later, Coal City's in the end zone, and that really gave them a big confidence boost.
Well, it was my opinion that they didn't adjust well. Carlinville did not adjust well to the weather. They were trying some things differently in the first half. And Coach Easton even said that they were going to try and do different things, and they were in the wrong formations, which they weren't accustomed to doing. Well, then they came out the second half, and early in the third quarter, they had real good field position. Tom, I feel if they had been able to score at that point, they could have made a better football game out of it.
But it was Coal City's defense that prevailed in the second half, so that wraps up our 2A state championship battle here at Hancock Stadium as Coal City wins it. Today's game has been produced and directed by Dave Turner. The graphics coordinator is Mark Brady. Our executive producer at Sports Channel is John Tuohy. Remote facilities were provided by Trio Video of Chicago. Once again, the 2A champion, the Kohlers of Coal City. For Bill Gorley, I'm Tom Stocker, saying goodbye for now. The proceeding has been an exclusive presentation of Sports Channel. Let's go back now to our studios. Steve Cashel on the Sports Channel Report.